So the function of the mirror state, says Lacan, is to establish a relationship between an organism and its reality, that is between Innenwelt and Umwelt, or between internal world and the environment. Unlike animals, human beings are not able to move about soon after birth. Human beings are born prematurely. Human beings' development into an independent individual is both physiological development and a psychical process which confers on us the internal images which we use to orient ourselves in our reality. In Lacan's view, this psychical development does not overcome the helplessness that we have experienced as an infant. Man has a certain dehiscence. Dehiscence means splitting open of a pod. We have this at the very heart, which persists throughout our existence. The word dehiscence means a splitting or bursting open of a pod, which is a stage in the developmental process. Lacan uses this term to refer to the primordial nature of the human subject as physically uncoordinated and psychically split. Lacan points out that the human brain contains an organic component that serves to register the human being's image of itself, which is like a mirror inside the mind. Lacan says that the mirror stage projects the individual into history. If our lives can be considered as plays and each of us playing the role of a character or protagonist in our lives, then this character is fictional. It is fabricated in the mirror stage when the infant's reflected image presents itself as a way of overcoming the infant's sensation of bodily fragmentation and powerlessness. The fantasies proceed from a fragmented image of the body to orthopedic form of its totality and to the finally donned armor of an alienating identity, and this will mark the subject's entire mental development with its rigid structure, which means that the fictional I serves at once as a kind of orthopedic brace that holds the unruly fragmenting organic drives into a coherent whole and as a defense against the impulses arising from these drives. So the mirror stage functions like a brace that seeks to hold the subject into a stable position. Lacan now turns to visual arts to explain psychic operations. The fragmented body is regularly manifested in dreams at the level of aggressive disintegration of the individual. The phantasmagorical images of bodies in Bosch's painting of modern man correspond to manifestations of unconscious drives in the mental and physical symptoms of hysteria. Lacan points out that the eye formation is symbolized in dreams by a fortified camp or even a stadium. Lacan here draws a connection between dreams and artistic creation. Dreams frequently contain images of fortresses or enclosures that divide the landscape into interior and exterior spaces, which corresponds to the subject's id and ego respectively. The adventures of the dreamer symbolize the relationship between the id and the ego. Lacan also notes that people suffering from obsessive neurosis often speak about fortified structures, which are actually metaphors for subject's isolation and displacement. Lacan does not want to build his ideas on subjective data alone, because then his theoretical efforts would remain unexposed. So he prefers to use a method of symbolic reduction as his guiding grid. It means the symbols taken for analysis are not creative imaginations of any particular subject, but manifestations of the basic mental organization of human beings. Psychoanalysis provides a theoretical grid to analyze such symbolizations. Anna Freud suggests that certain disorders like hysteria, obsessional neurosis, and paranoia can be linked to particular stages within the formation of the I, that is when the specular I gives way to the social I. At the end of the mirror stage, the relationship between the infant and her ideal I becomes the foundation for the child's social relationships and for the child's self-image as a social being. Lacan illustrates this by taking the child psychologist Charlotte Bout's idea of transitivism. That is, a young child may cry in pain when he sees another child injured. This kind of transitivism does not persist in elders It means the child's I will continue to be dependent upon others for its stability and coherence. Lacan views jealousy in pre-verbal infants as another indication of how the child's experience of selfhood is bound up with the presence of others. The process of human maturation, he says, is dependent in man on cultural intervention. For example, the subject's choice of sexual object is dependent upon the Oedipus complex. In short, we are what we are in relation to other people. Our knowledge of the world comes to us by the way of other people. Lacan speaks about Freudian theory of primary narcissism here. The infant develops two strong libidinal attachments, one to his mother and then to his own ego. Sexual libido or object libido in Freudian terms is directed outward toward persons and things. Libido or ego libido is invested in the ego. The ego libido has both positive and negative impacts. It is positive in the sense that we need it to nourish our bodies. It is negative because the ideal I never fully corresponds to the entity the subject experiences as himself or herself. This leads to disappointment, frustration, and anger. In Lacan's terms, we never measure up to our ideal I, and this failure emerges in our psychosocial lives in the form of insecurity, envy, and hostility. Lacan uses the image of Good Samaritan to suggest that even our acts of self-sacrifice are driven in part by the need to shore up our ideal image of ourselves. The image the subject perceives in the mirror stage creates a negative dimension in the subject's existence. For the subject, he or she is never fully himself or herself because the relationship within which the ego, that is I, comes into being is a relationship with an image that is not himself or herself but an unattainable ideal. Lacan here draws a parallel between this negativity and the alienation and meaninglessness of existence explained in the philosophical movement of existentialism. He claims the superiority of psychoanalysis over existential philosophy. Lacan tries to understand the human experience in the present-day society based on his theoretical model of the mirror stage and its implications about the nature of the psyche. Modern life, he says, is organized along the lines of a concentration camp, and existentialism offers a weak response to these dehumanizing conditions. To some degree, existentialism and psychoanalysis share a fatalistic view of what it means to be human. Both emphasize the mortality and materiality of human existence, but neither recognizes anything like a transcendent soul. For Lacan, our knowledge of our existence is always mediated through the system of imaginary psychic and social relations that structure our sense of self. Quoting Anna Freud, Lacan suggests that the operation of Wahrnehmung or negation is fundamental to the misrecognitions that structure our experience of ourselves and of reality. Wahrnehmung means a mental process in which the subject formulates the content of an unconscious wish in a negative form. The content of the wish finds expression in the consciousness, yet the subject continues to disown it. The subject disowns the instinctual drives in order to function as a normal human being, but the reality of the subject's aggression, sexuality, and mortality does not go away. These distressing truths about the subject form the id, which puts constant pressure on the consciousness and which may erupt in dreams, neurosis, and psychotic episodes. The I formed in the mirror stage is an internal fortification against the forces of the id. It is also the defensive suit of armor in which the subject ventures into the world. The ego can experience the world as a hostile environment and can try to remain static in the midst of the dynamic and potentially destructive events of the daily life of the mind. Incidents of psychosis occur when the fortification breaks down and the subject can no longer distinguish the internal form and the external world when the external world captures the ego. Forms of neurosis and madness in human mind is hard to avoid because ego maintains a dialectical, contingent relationship with the it and the world outside. In short, there is no normal mind. The idea of normality is an unattainable characteristic of the ideal I. He decrees the deadening rationalization of the modern social life. Lacan now focuses on how psychoanalysis occupies a space between the physical nature and the culture that human beings create for themselves. Lacan shows how psychoanalysis is a guide even to anthropology and how psychoanalysis is in the best position to understand human culture. The ego's life and the collective life of the culture in which the ego participates is dominated by desire, which Lacan calls love. The love refers in particular to the transference relationship between the patient and the analyst. Lacan says that psychoanalysis is not an altruistic profession meant to help others, but rather a philosophical exercise for both analyst and the patient, not to feel better, but to have a better understanding of the human condition.